Shellfish is big business. The shellfish industry is worth millions of pounds to the United Kingdom. Markets are lucrative. The best prices are often obtained abroad, so much of our shellfish catch is exported to countries like France and Spain. The most prized shellfish are usually caught with pots or traps. Around our coasts, fishermen set many thousands of shellfish traps every day when the weather allows. Shellfish trapping is done by boats of all sizes, from Land's End to John O'Groats. Fishermen are after prime quality shellfish and are prepared to invest the time and effort needed to catch them. The financial rewards can be high for those who are successful. There's a huge variety of types used to catch several different species of shellfish, and yet remarkably little is known by either fishermen or scientists as to how these shellfish traps actually work when they're down on the seabed. The inshore waters of western Scotland provide an ideal environment in which to observe shellfish. Here in these most productive waters, a team composed of divers and fishing gear technologists use camera equipment to observe how shellfish are caught. Divers from the Seafish Aquaculture Unit at Arbtow were able to position cameras accurately on the seabed and obtain some remarkable footage of these traps. Over the next few minutes, we're going to show how shellfish traps are set, how the target species is enticed into the trap, and what can happen once the animal has been caught. Traps are used successfully to catch several commercially important shellfish species. Most of these are crustaceans like lobsters and crabs, but whelks are also caught in traps. Shellfish traps are often called pots by some fishermen and creels by others. They are set in strings. The number of traps in the string depends on the depth of the water, stowage space available on deck, and the way the crew handle the traps on board. Each end of the string is marked at the surface with a float. If the local tides are very strong, anchors may have to be used at each end of the fleet. Once the traps are set, they're left in the water to fish. The fishing time depends on which species the fishermen want to catch and local conditions. Lobsters are caught along the edges of rough ground, close to weed-covered outcrops, wrecks and other underwater obstructions. Fishermen aim to set their traps as close to this type of cover as they can. Some types of trap are designed with soft entrances made of netting. Others have rigid plastic spouts. Lobsters usually enter a trap forwards. They only go backwards into holes that they've previously explored and know to be safe. Smooth plastic spout entrances can present difficulties for lobsters, depending on their size. This lobster is making a determined effort to get at the bait. His determination is soon rewarded. Problems arise when visitors come to dinner. Aggression in the close confines of the trap forces evasive action. These traps are designed with a separate compartment or parlour. To a lobster, this appears to offer a convenient escape route. Once the lobster has found its way into the parlour, its chances of escape are greatly reduced. If the trap becomes crowded, then fighting among the occupants can lead to injury or even loss of limbs, and therefore a loss of catch quality. In contrast, prawns live in burrows found in soft, muddy ground. They prefer conditions of low light, particularly when feeding. They venture out of their burrows at dawn and dusk to look for food. In the right place, baited creels can be very effective at catching prawns. It's extremely difficult to observe prawns under natural lighting conditions. Their eyes are very sensitive and are easily damaged if exposed to strong light. It is possible to acclimatise them under artificial conditions, but in order to observe their normal behaviour, it's necessary to use some special equipment. Infrared lighting and infrared sensitive cameras reveal the prawn's true nocturnal activities. Time-lapse photography helps us to see the prawns in a completely new light. Thank you. Brown crabs are often caught on the same kind of grounds as other shellfish. They're found on sandy areas around dense cover, like these kelp beds. This brown crab is trying to enter a trap that's been set to target velvet crabs. These brown crabs have been caught in a trap set to catch lobsters. Crab traps, or pots, also have entrances designed to make escape difficult. This is a plastic spout type of entrance, fitted in the top of a parlour-style trap. This similar trap has two soft entrances made of netting, but has no parlour section. This kind of entrance is designed for easy access from the seabed, while preventing the crab's escape. This is a traditional inkwell-style crab pot. It has a plastic spout entrance at the top and a heavy weighted base. The bars are protected from seabed abrasion with rope and strips of rubber. Time-lapse photography shows these crabs constantly probing for a means of escape. Trap fishing for whelks is a relatively new fishery in the United Kingdom. Whelk traps can be made from any smooth plastic container, and they resemble a weighted bucket. The top of the trap has a skirt made of netting, with an entrance hole in the middle. The trap is baited with pieces of waste fish. Drainage holes in the trap sides also allow the scent of the bait to diffuse out and attract the whelks. These whelks have their shells covered with heavy weed growth. The whelks are able to climb easily up the sides of the trap. They then enter the hole in the netting and drop down inside. They can't escape, because they can't grip the underside of the netting. Again, time-lapse photography reveals the behaviour patterns of these animals. These pictures are accelerated by 20 times over a 6-hour period. The whelks are competing with shore crabs and starfish for the bait in the trap. A trap like this can completely fill with whelks in as little as 6 hours. The inshore waters around the west coast of Scotland are important fishing areas for velvet crabs. These animals are caught in lightweight creel traps. The creels are set very close inshore on hard, rocky grounds. They are well camouflaged, are excellent swimmers, and are often very active and aggressive animals. These crabs live among rocks and kelp where tidal currents and wave surge is very strong. Being active animals, it doesn't take them long to find the bait in the creels. Velvet crabs are sold alive to a mainly Spanish market. It's therefore important for fishermen to pay particular attention to catch quality. Spider crabs can also be caught in traps. These animals are quite large, spiny creatures and have long legs and claws. Modified inkwell pots with a wide plastic spout entrance are used to catch them off southern England and Wales. The only means of marking the seabed position of each end of a string of traps is with a float on the surface. If these floats are lost from both ends, for example because of bad weather, then unless the traps can be retrieved with a grapnel, they could continue to catch shellfish while they remain lost on the seabed. This is known as ghost fishing. To try to prevent ghost fishing, traps can be built with doors that will open after prolonged immersion in salt water. This allows the previously captive animals to escape, which is good for conservation. Several innovations have been incorporated into the basic design of trap entrance to further prevent the escape of an animal once it's entered the trap. These act as a non-return valve. Traps can catch animals that aren't wanted by the market. Unwanted bycatch taken with traps can be returned alive to the sea. Bycatches usually consist of small fish, hermit crabs and starfish, together with several species of small crab. In the velvet crab fishery, there can be a significant bycatch of shore crabs, that's only landed and sold when market prices make this an economic prospect. Prime shellfish are checked carefully to ensure that they meet the minimum landing size regulations for each species. To make traps more size selective, escape gaps can be built into the design. These gaps give undersized animals a quick way out of the trap before it needs to be hauled up. This small lobster is finding the gap just big enough to wriggle through and escape the trap. Traps can be made more species selective. This brown crab can't squeeze into the narrow entrance of this velvet crab creel, and so won't become caught. This velvet crab will be able to escape through the wide bar spacings of this pot, which is set for brown crabs. By using traps responsibly to catch prime shellfish species, fishermen can get a very high-quality product to the market. This video film has shown you some aspects of shellfish trapping and what can happen down on the seabed. However, this is not the whole story. There's still much more to be discovered about how shellfish interact with fishing gear.